What's up, geeks, and welcome to the channel. Throughout this series, we've been downloading ready-to-use images. Images that have been created by others like the Hello World or BusyBox images. These are out-of-the-box images we found on Docker Hub. We downloaded them and then created a container out of them. In this video, we're going to see how we can build our own custom images so that we can run our own applications inside our own personalized containers. The process for making an image is somewhat straightforward, and like everything else, you must learn a little bit of syntax. So here's what we're going to do to make our own image. We're going to create something called a Dockerfile. This file is essentially a plain text file that is going to have a couple lines of configuration placed inside it. This configuration is going to define how our container behaves, or more specifically what different programs it's going to contain and what it does when it starts up as a container. Once we create that Dockerfile, we will then pass it to the Docker client, or CLI. The Docker client will provide the file to the Docker server, which is going to look at the lines of configuration that we have inside it, and then build a usable image that can be used to start up a new container. Now, that Docker file is where all the complexity is going to sit. In fact, just about every Docker file that you and I are going to put together is almost always going to look the same. Inside of every Docker file, we're always going to specify a base image, and we'll talk about what that means in just a moment. After that, we'll add in some configuration to run commands, which will install some dependencies, or some more programs that we need to successfully create and execute our container. And then finally, we will specify a startup command for the image, so anytime we take that image and create a container out of it, this command will be executed to start the container. That's it, creating our own image essentially just revolves around writing a Docker file. So all you need to do is create a new directory and underneath it, with the help of your code editor or without as you wish, create a new file and name it Dockerfile. Notice how it has a capital D and it has no extension, it is simply called Dockerfile. The process of filling the file we just created is going to follow this template of steps right here. So first we need to use an existing Docker image as a base. Then we're going to download and install a few dependencies. And finally, we're going to tell the image what to do when it starts as a container. Now, I'll be honest with you about the approach we're going to take. We'll start by writing all the code inside of that configuration file, then we'll use it to build our image, and then we're going to come back and talk about all the configuration that we've written inside it. Trust me, it's a lot easier to understand the configuration we're going to write after we've seen it in action or in the process of creating an image. So, the first thing we're going to write down is from Alpine. Then, in the next section, I'm going to add Redis as a dependency to that image using the run command. And finally, I'm going to add cmd, followed by a set of square brackets, a set of double quotes, and inside these, I'll put redis-server. Let's go inside our file directory and run the command docker build dot. Don't forget the little dot there. The progress plane argument we added will display extra logs for us, so we'll know what's happening. Okay, we're going to see a whole bunch of output very quickly, and then eventually we'll see a message that prints out an image ID for us. Now, we're going to take that very last ID printed out and use it to execute docker run. Our container is up. Redis server is now ready to accept connections. So we just went through the process of creating the Docker file and used it to build an image. Then we started that image up, but we haven't said anything about what really happened here. So let's go ahead and do a deep dive on all the configuration we added to the Docker file. To do that, let's look at every line in that Docker file. Notice how each line we put in there looks kind of like the others. Every line starts off with a single word that we refer to as an instruction. From, for example, is used to specify the Docker image that we want to use as a base to run the next instructions. Every line of configuration that we are going to add to a Docker file is always going to start off with an instruction. In this example, we used the three most important instructions, but there are quite a handful of other instructions out there which we will be looking at throughout the rest of this series. So you might guess that by putting from Alpine, we are saying we want to use a base image of Alpine when preparing our own image. Now, to break down what was really occurring behind the scenes with each of these instructions, we're going to first begin by looking at a little analogy. Suppose we have a brand new computer with nothing on it, not even an operating system, and we're being told to install Google Chrome on it. Probably the first thing you might do is try to turn on that desktop, and when you do that, you'd probably see some boot up process. But then you would eventually be given a message that says something like, "Hey, sorry, no bootable drive or no operating system." So the first thing you'd want to do is install an operating system. You need an operating system on that computer to go through to the next sequential steps. If you want to download Google Chrome, you must go download it from somewhere by opening a web browser, navigate to Google's website, download the installer, open a file explorer, and then execute that installer. These are all steps that are facilitated by the installation of that initial operating system. If we didn't have an operating system, there would be no default browser to start up, and we would have no way to run an executable file. So, these steps are very similar to what we did inside that Docker file when we specified that base image of Alpine. That was a lot like installing an initial operating system. You see, by default, when we create a container, we have an empty image. There's really nothing inside it, no infrastructure, no program to navigate around the file system, nothing we can use to download or install dependencies. So, the purpose of specifying a base image is to give us an initial starting point or initial set of programs that we can use to further customize our image. That's the purpose of that first line. An initial follow-up question might be, why did we use Alpine? What is Alpine? Well, why do you use Windows or Mac OS or Ubuntu? Because it kind of suits your needs. Windows might have a program that you need to use your computer effectively. You might use Mac OS because it has a built-in terminal, and that's nice for you. So, we made use of Alpine as a base image as kind of like an operating system of sorts because it includes a default set of programs that are very useful for what you and I are trying to accomplish. Here we are trying to install and run Redis, and the Alpine base image has a set of programs inside of it that are very useful for installing and running it. Okay, I think we've got a better idea of what's going on in the first line. Concerning the second line, by now you should have guessed that all we are doing here is using the set of tools provided by that base Alpine image to add the program we need, which is Redis here. So Alpine was our operating system and Redis is Chrome. And finally, to have a better understanding of the third line, let's go over the build process. Let's see how by running the docker build command, we take this file and generate an image out of it. You see, the build command is what we use to generate an image. Its right side specifies what we call the build context, which is the set of files and folders that belong to our project. We want to kind of encapsulate or wrap these files in this container. In this example, it is set to be the current directory. Notice how step 1 corresponds to the first line of our Docker file, and step 2 corresponds to the second line. So, the first thing that occurred was that Docker server reached out to Docker Hub, which, if you recall, is a repository of existing Docker images, and downloaded the image called Alpine. Then, the second command went through the process of downloading Redis and a couple of dependencies. So, now we should have a temporary container that has a file system snapshot that contains the newly installed copy of Redis. Then, after that package was installed, we moved on to step number 3 and we set the startup command of the temporary container we are generating to be the one mentioned in that step. So, the container does not actually execute that command, it just tells the container if you were ever to run for real, you should be running Redis server as your primary command. The container is told that this is supposed to be its primary command and then it shuts down and takes a snapshot of its file system and its primary command. The final image that was created out of this entire series of steps is the image we want. It has our file system snapshot with Redis installed and the startup command that has been specified. The ID of that last image is what's being returned to us in the very last line. Okay, in the last section of this video, I want to mention an important thing about the Docker build process, as that's what gives it so much performance. Let's go back to the Docker file and add any random command at its bottom. If you take a closer look at the flow of commands after we execute Docker build, you will notice that we still see the same steps, but we do not see any of the fetching image stuff, nor any of the sentences previously mentioned in the second step, nor any installation of dependencies. Instead, we see a single word that says cached. So, what this means is that Docker has realized that nothing has changed from the last time in the two first steps. And Docker knows that it has already executed these commands and that it has already generated an image out of these steps. And that resulting image was cached and stored on our local machine. So, rather than going through the process of creating another temporary container out of the Alpine image and running these commands inside that container a second time, it says, you know what, I've already done this work, I'm just going to use the image that I generated during the previous step again. But after Docker sees that there is a new command, it goes through the process of generating an intermediate container and run the new command inside it and takes its snapshot. Now, if we attempt to build that Docker file a third time without making any changes, Docker is going to process this one extremely quickly as it is going to use the cached version of the same image. Take note that if the order of operations is different, even if the operations are the same, then the cache can be used. So, the lesson here is that if you ever expect to have to change your Docker file, always try to put those changes as far down as possible. Okay, at this point we can create a new custom image out of our Docker file, then using the ID generated we can create a container out of that image with the help of Docker run. But in the previous videos of the series we had it way nicer, we were able to write stuff like Docker run hello world. In those cases we didn't have to use an ID, the image was referenced by a name or what we call a tag. And to tag our current image, what we can do is run docker build and add to it the -t argument, which will represent the tag of the image that is created and make it a lot easier to refer to it by a name that you and I can customize. If you don't put a version at the end, then the latest version will be applied by default, or you can add a version to your tag as you can see in front of you. So, that's it for this video. I hope it was helpful. Thank you guys for watching. Take care, and I will see you in the next one.